My name is Otani Kingi. I'm a researcher at Impact International. We're based in BC. And this is joint work with colleagues of mine at Impact, as well as at the FDA and our research, and Daniel here from Syracuse State University. I think we're going to shift the presentations from social media analysis to this paper, which is more social network analysis. And the paper can be summarized fairly briefly as follows. So, influence maximization is the problem of finding influential nodes within a network. And it's generally an intractable problem because the solution space grows in a combinatorial fashion with respect to the size of the network, and also evaluating the influence of a set of nodes is expensive as well. And therefore, the literature, which started in 2003, has largely been dedicated to the development of approximation algorithms, the best of which have a theoretical guarantee of achieving 63% or 1 minus 1 over E of the optimal solution. Now, where these approximations fall in the 63% to 100% range is an empirical question. And that empirical question has been difficult to answer in the past because it requires knowing the optimal solution, which, of course, the intractability of which motivated the literature in the first place. But fortunately, we realized that a recent theoretical breakthrough, which was exploited to develop what is now the state-of-the-art approximation algorithm, can also be used to compute exact solutions, at least for medium-sized networks. And so that's what we do, and we find that the approximate solutions always achieve at least 99% of the optimal solution, and that accuracy does not depend at all on network structure. And so basically this talk is expanding on that and providing a bit more detail. So today I'm going to briefly give an introduction to influence maximization. I'm going to talk about the two camps of the approximate solutions in the literature. I'm then going to build on that and show you our exact algorithm that we developed. And then I'm going to present you a series of results from a bunch of experiments that we ran. Okay, so as I mentioned, informally, influence maximization is the problem of finding which nodes are most influential. There are a lot of applications from viral marketing to public health to epidemiology. And to shift towards the formal statement of the problem, we need to know about two objects. One is the network represented by a graph consisting of a set of nodes V and a set of edges E. The other is a mechanism by which influence spreads from node to node across a network. And that propagation mechanism implies a spread function, sigma, which takes a subset of nodes S, which we call the seed set, and spits out the expected number of nodes that are expected to be influenced by a propagation mechanism initiated at those nodes S. And with these formal objects in hand, we can define the influence maximization problem as a simple statement, which is to choose a subset of nodes S of size K in order to maximize the subsequent spread initiated at those nodes. And this problem was initially formulated in 2003 by David Kent and his co-authors. So what does this look like? Well, here's two versions of an identical network. And here are two potential seed sets of size K equals 3. And as we see, each of them has a different size of spread as they influence the network. And just visually here, we can see that the spread of seed set S1 on the left is greater than the spread of S2. And therefore, S2 is not going to be a solution to the influence maximization problem. So before I get into the technical detail here, I think it's useful to understand a little bit about the history of this literature. So as I mentioned, the general problem is intractable because the size of the domain is really big. It's the size N choose K, which grows extremely fast with respect to N, the size of the network. Also, we had to estimate spread function sigma, and we do that via Monte Carlo simulations, which are expensive. So as I mentioned, David Kemp started the literature in 2003 by stating this problem. They also came up with the initial approximation algorithm, which is called the Greedy algorithm. And for 10 years, the literature developed basically tweaking that basic Greedy algorithm. Until 2014, Christian Walls and his co-authors came up with a really ingenious way to flip the book and provided a dramatic shortcut, and this is called reverse influence sum. And this is the theoretical breakthrough I mentioned that we use finally to compute the exact solution. So in the last year or so, us and another group of authors, Lee et al., have had a similar intuition about using this to compute exact solutions. They use a linear programming kind of approach. We use a brute force GPU approach. Okay, so let's quickly go over what the Greedy approximation looks like. If you're familiar with these kind of things, this will look somewhat familiar. So it's a hill climbing procedure. So for each of the k iterations, we just evaluate the spread of all the nodes in the network and grab the node that has the largest spread. And as we can see, this runs in k, n, and mc time, where mc is the number of Monte Carlo simulations that we require to estimate the spread function. And this is much faster than the optimal solution, remember, which runs in n choose k time. Now, it turns out that the spread function is submodular. And what does this mean? Well, this is the way I like to think about it is it's a set function analog of a concave function. So the spread of a given node coupled with a bunch of other nodes is, or the marginal spread of adding that node is lower than the marginal spread of adding it from a previous iteration. And there are a bunch of nice results that come from submodular functions. One of them is that constructing the solution in a greedy manner ensures that the resulting solution is within a factor of 1 minus 1 over e of the optimal solution. And this is that 63% that I mentioned earlier. So this 1 minus 1 over e comes from the fact that sigma is submodular. This other epsilon thing comes from the fact that we have to approximate the spread function. But we can make that as small as we like by simply increasing the number of Monte Carlo simulations. Okay, so that's the Greedy solution. I'm now going to give a brief overview of the reverse influence sampling approach. In order to understand this, we need to talk about this concept of a random reverse reachable set. And I think the best way to explain this is to simply show an example, a visual model. So here's the familiar network from earlier. We're going to randomly delete some nodes. And we're going to delete some nodes based on the propagation probability attributed to each node. So remember, the spread function underlying that is some propagation mechanism. And that mechanism is a function of the probability that an influence is carried across an edge. And so if we simply delete edges with that same probability, that's equivalent to simulating the spread process. So we can think of this as deleting edges or taking an instance of the network. After we do that, we choose a random node uniformly. And then we define the random reverse reachable set as the collection of nodes that are still connected to that randomly chosen node once we've deleted the edges. Okay, so just to give another example, here's the full network. Here's a random deletion of edges. We're going to randomly choose a source node, and we're going to define the random reverse reachable set as all the nodes connected to it. And so what does it mean for a node to be in a reverse reachable set? Well, for it to be in one set, we know that there is some probability that that node influences a randomly chosen node. And taking that intuition, what does it mean for a node to be in a lot of reverse reachable sets? It means that there's a high probability that that particular node is going to influence around the chosen node. And so if we see this node here is in both random reverse reachable sets, and therefore it gives us some information that that node might be highly influential. And so it's that intuition that kind of motivates this whole reverse influence sampling approach. And what this says, this is the important thing, and what it says is we can estimate the spread function sigma using this object f. And what is f? It's simply the fraction of the sets when we generate a really large number of random reverse reachable sets that are covered by a set x. So what we've done is we've transformed a expensive simulation object, which we need to compute via Monte Carlo, to a simple counting object. And that saves us a lot of time. And then a corollary of this lemma is this one. We can ignore this ugly part here for intuition. What it says is if we simulate a sufficient number of random reverse reachable sets, then the difference between the thing we want to know, the spread, and the thing we can compute really easily is small. And so those lemmas imply this algorithm, and it proceeds in two steps. One, generate a whole bunch of random reverse reachable sets, and two, find the set of nodes that occurs in most of them agree with. And so you'll notice that all this simulation work has been taken out of the big loop. So that's all done at the start. And then within this loop is just the counting procedure, which is really cheap. And so if you recall, the greedy procedure runs in kn times nc. Now we've got just in kn. Plus the simulations at the start. And just like the spread function is submodular, so is our counting function. And therefore, standard result submodular functions, we get the same approximation. Okay, so with that under our belt, we can move on to what we actually did. So just restating the RAS problem, this is exactly the same as before. Our approach modifies it to this. So step one is exactly the same, but rather than constructing the solution in a greedy fashion, we actually just try all the candidates. So this is still running technically in n choose k time, but the hidden factor is just a lot smaller because we're just counting. So we can use this to compute optimal solutions, and therefore we can use it to assess the accuracy of the approximate solutions. And just there's a few prior steps to proof, but the final step is actually fairly simple. So this is the spread of the seed set that we get from our RAS exact algorithm. We now remember from that lemma that it differs from that the spread of it differs from the count by a small amount. And we know by the definition of this seed set that it maximizes this function, and therefore we know that it's greater than the actual optimal solution. Reapplying the lemma again, we get this, and then rearranging, we get this. And so we know that our solution is within factor 1 minus epsilon of open t, and we can directly control this by simply simulating more random reverse reachable sets. Okay, so now what do we do with this? Well, recall we're still needing to count a large number of objects, and so we do this using a GPU, which is actually really nice. So counting is a simple procedure, so it's embarrassing in parallel, and we just distribute it to GPU threads. We do this on Amazon Web Services. We code this all up in Python using the number package. The number package allows us to communicate with the CUDA threads of the GPU. And in terms of the actual implementation of the coding, there are two distributed objects. One is this really big collection of random reverse original sets, and we represent that with a binary array where n is the size. The theta is this number of sets we're simulating, n is the number of nodes in the network, and an entry within that large array is true if node j is in that particular reverse original set. And the other is this object c, which is just a really long vector of entries k, where each entry gives the count of the number of reverse original sets that a set covers. And so the solution to the RAS exact algorithm is just the highest value c. Okay. And we run a bunch of experiments. So we're interested in knowing, does the accuracy of these algorithms differ with respect to the network? And we choose three of the canonical types of network used in the literature. These allow us to change particular network properties. So the Erdős-Renyi framework allows us to change network density. The Watt-Strogatz framework allows us to change the amount of clustering within a network. And the scale-free setup allows us to change the degree to which a network exhibits scale-free properties, which is also an important characteristic of networks. We do a bunch of different configurations of those networks, a bunch of different propagation probabilities determining the spread, and for each of those we generate 10 graph instances, so that altogether we're running about 1800 simulations, which takes about 4 days. We played around with network size and seed set size, and our results didn't really differ too much, so we just stuck with a network size of 100k equals 4. And what we found is that within all our simulations, all the approximations achieved greater than 99%. So these are, what we're plotting here is this thing we're calling delta, which is simply the spread of the approximate solution divided by the spread of the exact solution. And we see that they're all about, well above 99%. So these plot the means, where the average is taken over all parameter configurations and instances of each type of network with a 95% confidence. And then, so we actually, because all the results were almost 100%, we actually struggled to find any kind of pattern across the networks at all. One small pattern we did find is that as this is a comparison of the Erdős-Renyi network that defines network density, so the ratio of nodes to edges. As that network density increases, we get a slight improvement in the accuracy of the algorithm. So again, we're talking about 99%. And so that's it. So just to recap, we developed this RAS exact algorithm, which exploits this reverse inference sampling concept so that we're able to compute exact solutions. We found that the approximations are perfect. So although they're only theoretically guaranteed to find at least 63%, they in fact find 99%, and that's a really big, in terms of the practical use of these approximations, it's a really good assurance for people using them. And further, we found that the accuracy of these algorithms don't depend at all on network structure. Thanks.
So how sensitive is any of the exact solution or approximate solution? Let's say that network has deleted a few edges or added a few edges, will the solution still be the same?
Yeah, so that is kind of largely the question we're trying to answer, that this graph gets at. So we can see that the difference between the network density at this edge and network density down here is simply the deletion of a bunch of edges. And so there is kind of a somewhat positive relationship here, but the overall takeaway is that it doesn't depend on the deletion of edges.
Okay, thanks. Any more questions?
If you go back a few slides to the last one,
the last
algorithm that you created, the exact one,
sure.
Where it showed comparison, would you mind briefly just explaining them for us and choose game candidates? So is that the part where you're selecting a node, randomly selecting a node, and then going off of the edges that are connected to it?
No, not quite. So a solution to these algorithms is some subset of nodes of size k. That subset being the most influential nodes. One way to construct that is to, for each of those size k, just check the count of each node and then put them on the highest one in, and do it again for the next highest. That doesn't quite give you all combinations of potential seed sets. So what this one does is it does, so there are n choose k, different size k seed sets that are potential candidates for a solution within the network, and this just says check all. So rather than doing k times n loops, you're doing n choose k loops. So this takes a while.
In order to cover all the solutions for
yep.
that case.
The way, so if you're constructing a basketball team, that would be like choosing the best players from each team and putting them together. This metaphor is going to work. Whereas that wouldn't necessarily be a better team than choosing all the players together to complement each other. Anything that can be expressed within a network framework. So the general problem started in viral marketing. So we have an Instagram network, and if we're wanting to send our sneakers to k equals 10 people in order to get the largest views of these sneakers, we choose those 10 nodes in such a way as to do that. Another application, actually something that I'm working on in New Zealand is the spread of disease. So we had a network of farms and that connected with movements of trucks. We're interested in identifying which farms, if they get infected, are most likely to cause a epidemic. So yeah, so there's kind of two different problems but both can be expressed.
So I may be like not familiar with influence, but it kind of reminds me. So how is the relationship between influence versus like some simple metric like the centrality of the node or the connectedness of the node? Any correlations?
Yeah. So the there are two kind of approximation, two camps of approximation algorithms. One are theoretically guaranteed, and those what I've talked about today. Others are kind of general heuristics that are cheap to compute, like you might just choose the nodes with the highest number of edges or the highest centrality. In practice, they tend to do quite well, but there's no theoretical guarantee around them. So there's a bit of a trade-off between speed and guarantee there. But yeah, those are really popular.